studies across the electric grid and within cities, they found that 86% of the energy that we're consuming goes to waste. So if you have 100 tons of coal, let's just make it happen, into the furnace, 86 tons is literally lost. 14 tons goes to work to drive industry and manufacturing, to power the lights and to project in this room, to heat and cool our homes. 14% of that. Why? Oh, we have a theoretical efficiency of the power plant, then we have transmission and distribution losses, then we have how efficient our buildings are with the types of lighting and the types of HVAC and the plug load and the appliances. When you add all of that together, it ends up being 80,000 pound gorilla, 86,000 pound gorilla. So the city of Orlando has been trying to figure out how we tackle that nut, and it's been a focus of mine in the last 3 years. The first thing is we've committed to making all city-owned buildings high-performance green buildings by the year of 2030. We've made the LEED Silver requirement for all new facilities that we build. We've built 14 new LEED certified buildings, from fire stations to the Amway Arena. And the other innovative things that Orlando has done that's getting recognition around the country is we've created an in-house energy company within our city. Most cities are risk averse of taking out bond capital to invest in their facilities, take the savings, pay down the bond over time, right? And keep that in-house. And so they'll hire an ESCO company to come in, like a Siemens or a Johnson Control, will come in and do that for them. I'll spend the money, but the term on these contracts are way longer than the return on investment. Way longer, and that's how they make money, and that's okay. And for cities that are cash strapped and they don't have a good bond and they're risk averse, that may be a good solution. For us, we're AAA bonded, and it's a no-brainer for us to take $17.5 million we've been approved by the CFO and invest in 55 of our buildings, yielding $2.4 million in annual savings each year. Half of that money being taken to pay the debt over 15 years. The other half recycling in a revolving energy fund. Now we have a pot of money that we're able to reallocate to more and more buildings to keep getting more and more efficient. No brainer. Funding and financing becomes a huge challenge. So last year, and I'm talking more about the private sector, right? How do we now get our homes and our building owners to also reap the same benefits that the city was able to do? And usually the first step is that I'd love to have LED lights in my room and put solar on my roof, but it's a steep upfront cost with great savings. So we passed PACE, the Property Assessed Clean Energy Financing Tool, providing 100% of the capital that you need to make improvements, repaying through the property tax roll over extended terms, it could be 15, 20, 25 years, and now you can find a cash flow savings from day one through this mechanism, right? If you take out $10,000 and I'm saving $100 a month for my investments, that's $1,200 per year, and I stretch that $10,000 over 10 years, what am I paying? $1,000 per year. Now I'm cash flow positive $200 from day one just to improve my building. No brainer. Now we're talking with Simon Malls. I'm doing a multi-million dollar PACE project. We're talking with commercial buildings. We've done over $850,000 in assessments in the last 6 months in just Orlando. So we've been finding tools, financial tools, to help the market invest in clean energy without any of the out-of-pocket upfront expense. Right? One of the most historic policies that we passed last December was what's called Building Energy and Water Efficiency Strategy, or BWES. And this is very similar to having a miles per gallon in a car, right? You go to a car lot and every car has an MPG, and we can make an informed decision about what car we want to drive, how far we want to go in a gallon of gas. Well, when you go to rent an apartment or move your business to an office building downtown, you don't know the cost of utilities or the cost of rent. You know the cost of rent, you don't know the cost of utilities and the full cost of operations. So we passed a policy that now requires, starting this May coming up, every building above 50,000 square feet to go through a process called energy benchmarking, using a free tool, Energy Star, Portfolio Manager, all of us have probably heard of Energy Star. That tool gives you a score from 1 to 100 of how efficient your building is. 100 being the best, 50 is the national average, 1 is the worst. And when we start to measure and monitor our performance, we start to enlighten ourselves about what the savings could be, right? You can't manage what you don't measure. Well, now we're requiring the measurement, the reporting to the city, and we make that fully transparent to the marketplace. So now when you go to rent an apartment, you will be able to see the cost of rent and the cost of utilities, and the cost of rent and the cost of utilities over here. And that actually has created a cycle of improvement. This, we're the first city in the state of Florida to do that, and already Miami, Tampa, and Jacksonville have reached out and they're interested in moving in that direction as well. For energy, this past week, you may have seen online some very exciting news in Orlando. We have had a goal to move 100% of our municipal buildings to renewable energy by 2030. But this past week, we passed a historic policy with the help of the First 50 Coalition, with the League of Women Voters, with Sierra Club, with Ideas for Us, with NAACP, with many other organized Florida, many other groups, CCL. And what happened was, this city committed to moving towards 100% renewable energy by mid-century. And now the world knows about it. I think how is the real question. How are we gonna get there? Well, we've been working with OUC. We have utility scale solar farms. I've already started to invest in on-site solar for city buildings. This is a 420 kilowatt system, net producer of power into the grid. I found multiple megawatts on top of our city buildings. And through OUC, we've started two really creative programs. One's a community solar program, where people can subscribe from their apartment into a large community array and take a certain number of panels, and all of us collectively, almost like a community garden, help provide the demand for that array, right? Which is really neat. We now have a 13 megawatt community solar farm coming online next month. It's on top of a coal ash landfill, quite ironic. And it will be one of the first, it's certainly the highest in the state in terms of the array. And also a solar aggregation program. A lot of people know about Florida Sun, and I sit on that board as well. And we've been starting to replicate these community solar, these cooperatives right around the state. Mary DuBois, I saw, was here, and Michael Cohen. This is a revolutionary model in Florida with a regulated utility marketplace. We need creative ways to lower the total cost. And if we bundle together, we can do that. Well, OUC said, well, at least in our service territory, this may be a cool model for us to provide a value-added service to our customers. And that's a really interesting and unique approach for a utility who's trying to stay alive in this ever-changing marketplace, right? And lastly, we started to test photovoltaics. We're the land of retention ponds, right? These retention ponds are stormwater ponds that really don't have any other value other than that. So how do we start lining these retention ponds? And we just installed a 35 kilowatt grid tied system that, of course, the video doesn't play here, but basically was rolled out and is now producing power onto the grid. We have identified tens and tens of megawatts of power on top of water bodies that we can use instead of taking out greenfield, let's put it on our water bodies, right? Solid waste, we started to look through food waste collection. We have now compressed natural gas trucks, and of course CNG is dependent on fracking. How do I get off of fracking and still use a technology like CNG? Well, organics, normally they get dumped into the landfill, or will create methane, which is another major greenhouse gas that we have through an anaerobic environment. Well, we decided to do two things. We said, well, one, we need to start educating our residents about how to divert food waste from the landfill. So we launched a completely free of charge residential composting program. Every single resident can sign up online. We send them shipped and assembled composter, 80 gallon earth machine composter, and they put it in their backyard and they start diverting food waste. Why? Well, we pay the county to tip into the landfill. We pay $35 per ton. I found these things wholesale for $33 a ton, our office. In 3 years, it diverts a ton, it's a 10-year warranty asset. The solid waste director said, that's a no-brainer. We'll buy thousands of them, we'll send them out, people will literally start to use them if we educate them, and they have, and we'll literally save the city tens of thousands of dollars by doing it. Being smart economically, being smart for the planet, right? But commercial food waste is really the tough nut to crack. We're the hospitality industry of this country. We have more theme parks, more hotels, more restaurants than a lot of cities, and they produce a lot of waste. In fact, 30 to 40% of our waste is being tipped right now is organics. So, we launched a commercial food waste collection program, and in partnership with East End Market, which was one of the first anchor tenants, Publix, Hyatt at the airport, a lot of others, IKEA was doing a ton, of course, Golden Corral, they're perfect for this program. We have diverted 2.5 million pounds of food waste in just 18 months. And this is our How do I continue to scale that? There's probably 26,000 customers we can hit, and with 26 stops, we're picking up 2.5 million pounds of food waste. Now, we take this right now to an anaerobic digester. This is a biogas plant that turns organics and fog, fats, oils, and grease, and also wastewater sludge into biogas that gets right now burned into a natural gas turbine and makes energy for the stuff on the grid. Not ran by the city, separately ran. The idea, though, is how do I close loop that CNG system, like I said in the beginning? Well, we have a vision over the next 10 years for us to collect enough food waste to take to a similar plant that we own, compress it into CNG, and run the entire solid waste fleet of the food waste that we're collecting. Now we're not dependent off of fracking, and we can continue to maintain these vehicles over and over. Think about that type of solution, right? We're getting smart about our waste. We're putting big bellies, which I know a lot of you see, these solar powered trash compactors. We're rolling out a number of them, even more. There's about 250 currently, and we're rolling out even more. And the cool thing about these is they have a volumetric sensor. They tell us in real time how full one bin is over another. So when we're deploying people, and we're deploying vehicles, which are emitting into the atmosphere, we can start to pinpoint exactly where we need to pick up and when we need to pick it up. Getting smart with our waste. And lastly, local food systems. This is obviously something I have an extreme passion in, being a co-creator of food farming. We have our food farming team here, Lee Perry, as our director. And I'll say that in Orlando, in many cities, we have food insecure communities. We have places where people have to walk more than a mile to get access to fresh food, and that's unacceptable. That's something that we need to completely change. So this is a map showing exactly where those desert pockets are. Those food desert pockets. Last year, Orlando applied and received one of only 11 grants around the country from the USDA called the Farmers Market Promotion Program Grant to create a West Orlando food hub in a low-income and food insecure community in partnership with Fleet and Ideas for Us, with the city, Orlando City Soccer, MU Nutrition, University of Florida, and others. The idea is, how can we scale the very innovative concept of fleet farming, of growing food on lawns and providing the excess food to market? How do we scale that in a community? Secondly, how do we expand community gardens to allow people to grow their own food? This is an example of Rock Lake and Spring Lake Manor Garden that looks like this today. Third, how can we add a market, an actual farmer's market, which they do not have. In partnership with your new Orlando City Soccer team and the Orlando City Soccer Stadium, which is blossoming in terms of camaraderie in our city, adding a farmer's market here, and lastly, teaching cooking and nutrition classes on a monthly and even expanding upon that on a quarterly basis to the community who's growing this food. We're really excited about the opportunity of expanding food systems. The last thing I'll mention is around vehicles. Yesterday, we received an electric bus in the downtown. I know Phil really is very happy about that. Right. We have a downtown bus rapid transit system that's free of charge. It's a service that the city provides to our residents. Right now, it's a diesel hybrid bus. The idea is I've been approaching the links and I've been bringing down these all-electric buses to test them out and demo them for one day. And now I've got their appetite to the point to where they want to do it for 2 weeks to a month to try to figure out how this works on the range, which route it works on, the charge capacity, the user experience, what are all these things look like. And yesterday we received a bus that for a week or 2 weeks, starting on Monday, we will be riding with passengers in the downtown core to collect that information and get their appetite wet for, in the next 5 years, converting that entire bus rapid transit system to all electric, zero emission buses. So we hear about Orlando. One of the things that people know about it is our theme parks and what Disney brought to the city in the 70s and 80s. Many of us know about the experimental prototype community of tomorrow. And the vision is, how can we make Orlando the experimental prototype city of today? this is the vision that we're moving towards, a smart and sustainable city that takes the concepts that Disney had in the late 80s and brings them into the fabric of the entire community so that it enhances public health, so that we drive a robust economy, and we protect the environment for generations to come. Again, thank you so much for the opportunity to share.